Let's talk about cars.
Welcome to the Motorious Podcast, where we talk about interesting car enthusiast news. I'm Steven Sims.
And I'm Elizabeth Puckett.
And thanks for tuning in. So Elizabeth, this past weekend, I saw the new Scream movie. It was interesting, but and I liked it, but I was disappointed in how little car culture they had in it versus the first three movies, well, especially the first two. Did you see the movie?
Yeah, we went and saw it at a drive-in this weekend too, and I saw that Super B. I thought that there was going to be something juicy there. Two scenes, sorry for the spoilers, but two scenes, then it was gone. That's it. That's all we got.
Yeah. Have such a classic Mopar muscle car in the movie. I saw in the preview and I was excited about that. I mean, I'm a fan of Scream, but to see, you know, something like that in there, I was, you know, excited, like maybe Ghostface was going to steal the car, go do an epic burnout and drag race some people and then kill them or something. I don't know, but they really didn't do much with it. So that was just
for Mopar. That would have been on brand for the average Mopar driver. Especially if you follow our site, that's what you think.
It would have been pretty epic, but yeah, it's still a good movie. Did you do anything else interesting over the weekend?
Well, it was snowing, so at the end of the snow, we got my car out, and we jumped in for a ride, because, you know, race car tires and all don't like the snow. But once it dried up, it was beautiful. I went for a ride, and then funny thing happened. John got an alert on his phone, and it said that there was an AirTag following us, but it was my AirTag, so it was
fine. Oh, it was your AirTag.
Yeah.
Wait. Yeah. So you got an alert for your own AirTag?
No, he got an alert for my AirTag.
He got the alert for your AirTag. Oh, okay. Because I was going to say, because I have an AirTag and I never get alerts for it. So
anytime he gets near one of my cars or my son has it on his keys, he gets an alert. And that brings me to question this whole AirTag business. I don't know. You guys.
Yeah, a lot of people use it as like an anti-theft device on their cars. I've seen that. A lot. Well,
that is why I bought mine, and I was really disappointed that it alerts you right away that there's an AirTag following you,
even though it's not yours.
Right. So it's supposed to be like an anti-stalking situation, which is all great, but all these people are reporting now that AirTags are being used in car thefts, and I'm not buying it. Just with my personal experience, I'm just not buying it. What do you?
So they're saying that people are putting AirTags on their car to track their car so that later they can steal it when it's parked, right?
Correct.
But yeah, I've seen that.
I've heard a bunch of stories about like them finding an AirTag and this and that and just these general stories, but I haven't heard of one car actually being stolen because of an AirTag. And the fact that it alerts you right away when you get in the car, if there's an AirTag that's not paired with your phone, really makes me question, is this just another urban legend? Like, it's just perfect urban fodder. It's using like modern technology, has that spy aspect, and then kind of has that like attention aspect. And I'm not saying that everybody who says that this is happening to them is lying. You know, it could be a prank pulled on them. Could, I don't know, maybe their girlfriend is trying to track them. But I'm not buying that a lot of car thieves are investing in technology when they can just pluck your car out of the parking lot or in your driveway.
So you think this is like the modern story of the guy who meets a beautiful woman, they have some drinks, and he wakes up in the bathtub of ice and his kidneys are gone?
Pretty much. Maybe not that severe, but this is a little bit more lighthearted.
I don't know. For some people, their car is probably more important to them than their kidneys. You know, they can do dialysis as long as they can still do burnouts.
I've felt like I could give up a kidney for a car sometimes. So yeah, I get that, but I just don't buy it. And it kind of steamed.
I saw a story about some supermodel or model. I don't remember who it was in New York. Who said that some guy dropped one in her purse and was trying to figure out where she lived doing that. And a lot of people are freaking out over that. And so this is basically like they're saying that they're doing this with cars, but, you know, they're trying to stalk the people so that they can take their car, like, say, a Hellcat.
Right. But car thieves are enthusiasts. Opportunists, sorry. I mean, obviously they're enthusiasts too. They're enthusiasts for crime. But yeah. They're opportunists. Like, they're going to walk by a car in a parking lot. And you know how quickly, me and you have both seen how quickly you can steal a Hellcat, for example. It takes like 8 minutes. So somebody inside of Publix, just grab the car. Why go through all the trouble of, you know, trying to stick an AirTag on there without anybody seeing you? And then follow them home later?
It's kind of like a hybrid of the story. We've covered this before, where some thieves, and it's been documented, have actually gone to car meets to go find rare classic cars to steal. So, I mean, you don't see those just sitting around everywhere.
Right.
And a lot of people keep them in garage, so you can just drive around and see where people have them. So they would put trackers on them and then see where the car went and then set up field cameras around the house to see when the people typically come and go and then plan when they're going to go get the car. But I mean, these cars are worth six digits. It's worth all that effort. And they're not using a $25 Apple AirTag to do it. They're probably using, you know, pretty advanced GPS system.
And that's the thing that I keep coming back to, is all these stories recently are centered around AirTags. There's been tracking devices that are cheaper and they don't snitch on themselves either. They've been around forever. I'm not going to name specific brands because I don't want anybody to get any ideas about, you know, how to do this the right way. But if I was going to steal a car, I wouldn't put an AirTag on it where somebody would know that it's there.
Yeah,
so that's where I'm coming to an end here.
I mean, I guess if you have an Android, you wouldn't know, but if the person has an Apple, a lot of people have Apple iPhones, then they would. Or if their friend gets in the car and they have an Apple iPhone, then they would know. It kind of reminds me of, in Breaking Bad, where Walter tracks Mike's car. I don't know, for anyone who's a fan of that show, and he uses the GPS tracker. But that was supposed to be back in like the early 2000s when GPS trackers were not very plentiful, and you know, the tracker wasn't exactly telling him, hey, there's a tracker on your car, you know, because no smartphones weren't a thing back then. So yeah, I mean, these AirTags, you're saying it alerts you if it's not your AirTag. Yep. And like, how long does it take to tell you that it's with you?
Right away. I mean,
right away.
Yeah, because like, we'll get in the car, remote start it, by the time we get the seats adjusted and the button pushed, it's already, his phone is already on off.
Interesting. I've tried to track the AirTag that I bought, and it works pretty well.
So I did try to find some validity to any of these stories, and it seems like most of them are coming out of Canada, which is sort of unusual. And there's one that's near Detroit that seems the most plausible, where a guy has, I'm not sure what year it is. It's a wide body. It looks like a Scat Pack. It says 392, but I don't see if it's a Scat Pack or not. Not an issue there, but he said that he gets home and he has an alert, and it seems the most believable story, but it could have been his friend playing a prank on him, or like I said, his girlfriend trying to track him. But the car wasn't actually stolen. I haven't heard of a car actually being stolen using an AirTag. Mm-hmm. And the Canadian police, I can't remember exactly where it was, but they were saying that it's happened, but they haven't actually said that it, like, they're like, oh, watch out for it, there's a lot of car thefts. Yes, there's a lot of car thefts, but why specifically the AirTags? And there hasn't been a report, so I'd like to know. And if I'm wrong, I'll admit that I'm wrong, but I'm just not buying it.
All right.
Again, you're listening to the Metorious podcast. If you would just subscribe, follow us, we're going to be on monthly. Hopefully we're going to build up to be on more than that. Leave us a comment, and then you can find us at metorious.com, where you can find all the things that we're talking about now in depth. So let's get into these headlines. The last couple of weeks, I want you to tell me about the stolen Porsche that took off down the sidewalk, and cops didn't know.
It was recorded in Seattle recently, this month. And it's a pretty crazy video where it shows a bunch of cops kind of standing by the curb, and you got this Porsche that's stolen, apparently, allegedly. I can't confirm that for sure, but that's what they're saying. And it just takes off down the sidewalk. And in my opinion, again, I know some might disagree, but in my opinion, it really looks like the cops don't really do anything to stop them. And they just watch it drive off, and a couple of the officers actually hang their heads after.
Yeah.
And the camera pans back to where they are. Just unbelievable. If that were my car, I would be furious. didn't do anything to stop the guy. They didn't throw out a stop strip. They didn't, you know, try to get in front of the car. I mean, I know that that's dangerous. They didn't try to break out the window. No. Nothing. Nothing. They just let the guy just drive off.
I don't think that they understood that a Porsche could drive down a very wide sidewalk. I think that they were just puzzled as to why this is happening. And they were first time for everything kind of situation. Or maybe it's because of their hands are tied because of...
Yeah, and it may be procedure that they're directed in that kind of situation to not pursue. Or the sergeant who was there told them to just stand down because of procedure. Their hands may have been tied. So I'm not, to be clear, I'm not blaming the officers per se. I'm just saying it's pretty ridiculous. Whatever the reason is, and maybe we have some Seattle PD people who want to send us a comment, let us know the reason why. It's just ridiculous that they just stood there and watched him steal the car. Pretty crazy.
Another story about cars that you're not going to see on the road or get back, these tornado damaged C8s. You know, we all know about the tornadoes that went on, unfortunately, in Bowling Green and the surrounding areas, and it affected the Corvette factory. And a lot of people are outraged that they're just going to get rid of these Corvettes. But the thing is it's more to do with like insurance. There's just, they're not just trying to pluck them off the road and throw them in the dumpster. You see any time that there's cars that are involved in any kind of disaster. I mean, if a dealership floods, anything, even if the cars weren't directly affected, you know, they're part of the insurance claim. So they got to be scrapped. And that's unfortunate, but it's just the reality of it.
Right. Well, plus a lot of people are basing their comments on these tornado damaged or allegedly tornado damaged cars from the factory in Kentucky on two admittedly pretty grainy photos. So you don't know if there really is damage on these cars or not. I mean, yeah, they look like they're fine. They're partially assembled in the photos, but you aren't walking around it and you're not inspecting it. Plus you're not a quality control guy of the factory. So they're probably, or there may have been, I can't say for sure, there may have been good reasons why they're scrapping these cars, or it may have just been the insurance said, hey, they're involved. We don't know if there's some micro damage on it, scrap them. And it's unfortunate because some people are going to be waiting longer for their Corvettes now. The wait times are already pretty long.
Yeah, I heard they were ramping up pretty big for next year, this year in production. So
yeah, well, they were at production capacity for this past year. So they were really churning them out. But still, I mean, so many people want the C8s. You have to wait a while to get one.
Right. Absolutely. And then our last kind of interesting headline so far this month is that Joe Rogan is a car guy. We knew he was a car guy, but he's like an authentic car guy. He was on his podcast recently with Carrot Top. And Carrot Top started talking about wanting a car. Of course, Rogan loves like those old resto mods. So he jumps on during the podcast and starts like scrolling for cars. And it was just, I don't know, it was just awesome how it was just like such a real car person experience where, I mean, we could lose a lot of time. And we do in meetings sometimes going through inventory and shopping for cars that we're never going to buy. But yeah, he pulled up the Vanguard website and he was just going through it and picking things out and getting excited about different features and different cars. So that was pretty cool to see.
Yeah, the one big difference is that I think Rogan can buy any of those cars or all of them if he wanted. So that's where he's different from the rest of us. I know some people were mad about this story saying, well, he doesn't wrench on his own cars and so on. I don't know if he does or not. I wouldn't be surprised if he doesn't. He's a busy guy. He has a lot going on. So can you fault him for that? I mean, yeah, no, I don't know. I don't know how much wrenching I do on my own cars if I were like him, because I imagine he has an extremely busy schedule. So
yeah. And I mean, after I got over the age of like 30, if I could pay somebody to do something, I probably would. I would probably have a mechanic like on that would be instead of having like a maid or anything like that. If I was a super rich person, I would just have like a car stable and people would take care of my cars for me. But I don't know, there's maybe Rogan works on his cars every now and then.
Maybe he does. I know, yeah, because sometimes it can be relaxing working on your cars, but sometimes it's completely frustrating. Yes. So.
there's a difference between changing the camshaft because you want to and changing the alternator because you have to. All you know, those are two completely different levels of skill there, but sometimes it's really fun, sometimes it's just a money pit. So yeah.
Well, again, he has the money, so
yeah
that's not a factor for him.
So let's dig into these comments here. We get some interesting comments, and we don't want you guys to comment just for the sake of commenting, but if you have anything you want to share that you think that we would find interesting, like, we'll definitely bring it up on the show if it is, you know, a topic that we want to talk about. But some of these comments, they're really funny. Some of them are really mean, and that's okay. We're thick-skinned. We're journalists. We're used to it. Some of them are really informative, and some of them are really uplifting. Like, I've read some comments where I was kind of feeling negative on a subject, but then I have a reader that comes in, they talk about, like, well, don't, you know, we're car people, we can do this. So some of the comments that we've gotten that we thought were funny, this Ellis DeLorean, this guy, Ellis swapped a DeLorean because why not? One of the comments was saying, now we're talking, if the DeLorean was made with some decent horsepower, I think the image would be way different. Was the power just the only problem with the DeLorean?
Well, I think it was one of the major issues. You know, the time machine in Back to the Future, they did an engine swap and threw a Porsche V8 in there because the car couldn't move like they needed it to for the scenes.
Did they really? I didn't know that.
Yeah, a lot of people don't know that. No, the DeLoreans were, I mean, cool cars in a way, iconic, but slow.
Yeah. I mean, the most iconic, I think, DeLorean I saw was not even in Back to the Future. It was that scene in The Wedding Singer where the jerk, like, fiance pulls up and he slings open the gold doors for her to get in. He's like, don't puke in the car. Like, that's... that's what I think of when I think of DeLorean. So,
well, some people may not have seen that one. I think everyone's seen Back to the Future, but no, The Wedding Singer. Yeah, that's a good one, though.
But I think a lot of people movie too. So yeah, and then another comment, you had posted about the Callaway C7, and this person, I've never seen this before, beats the current Corvette designs. That's an interesting take, because the C8s are so popular. Yeah. To see somebody not liking them is actually, I'm not gonna say it's refreshing, but it's a different opinion.
It's what it is. Well, you know, and I had fallen in love with the Callaway C7 back in the 90s when it first came out. I saw it in a magazine. I don't even remember which magazine it was. And I thought, wow, what a car. And I even, like, drew it because I was in an art class and I draw cars for that class. And my art teacher really loved it. And other people who saw the drawing that I did of the Callaway C7, they loved it. And I even got some adults, like, to become fans of the car. But it was rare. They only made two of them. So I didn't realize back then, though, and, you know, even until recently, that most people had never actually seen it, I guess, or a lot of people hadn't, because, you know, I knew about the car way back. So, yeah, it was great that I was able to educate some people, and especially for the time. I mean, that design was just crazy.
Yeah, it's wild. It's a wild looking car. But yeah. That's the Callaway formula. It's just, you can't ignore it. So yeah. All right, so that's what's going on right now in the automotive industry. Let's talk about the wild past. We recently talked about the murders of Mickey and Trudy Thompson, and this story reads out like a really suspenseful movie. So Mickey Thompson and his wife, for those who don't know, back in 1988, I believe it was, they were gunned down in their driveway, and they still don't know exactly who did it. There was two people in hoods, and they rode away on bikes. And they were just getting up to leave like any other day. And at the same time, Mickey Thompson's former business partner, Michael Goodwin, and that's the Goodwin you're thinking of, you know the name, he went and fled the country. Yeah. And also transferred a couple hundred thousand dollars with him to the Caribbean.
Not suspicious at all, is it?
Yeah. So that might have tipped them off, but by, you know, the nature of the crime, by the nature of the killing, the cops knew right away that this was a hit, because Trudy was just, she had a ton of jewelry on her. Mickey had cash, you know, it's the time when people actually carried cash around with them. Mickey had a ton of cash in his pocket and all of that stayed with them. Nobody, it wasn't a robbery. So they knew something was up, and Goodwin fleeing the country definitely threw up some, you know, red flags of why would he do this? You know, this is his business partner. Well, come to find out, Mickey Thompson and Goodwin had entered into an agreement for a promotional company, and they quickly fell out over finances, and they went to court over it, and the judge ordered that Goodwin paid Thompson $800,000, which would have completely bankrupted Goodwin at the time. So, you know, they kind of put it together, and when he comes back into the States, mysteriously, in 2001, he was arrested, and then in 2007, he was found guilty for murdering them both.
Well, for having them murdered, right? He didn't.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he didn't do
it. They think it was a murder for hire, right?
Yeah.
So I saw that people were saying that Goodwin had a reputation being difficult to work with and not being very fair with his business partners. Did you run across that?
I've heard that. I've also heard some interesting things that have come out of him since he's been incarcerated. He's had some interesting opinions about different things. So it wouldn't surprise me that he would be a difficult person. Let's end on a light note. That's a little heavy.
Yeah.
Let's talk about cars. So I'm going through the Meritorious inventory like I do every morning, and I find a car I really, really like. And we're going to link to these cars in the description so you can find them. But this one I chose, I know it's going to really shock you. It's a 2015 Charger police car, but it has a Hellcat swap. So I'm essentially...
so shocked.
I never would have guessed Hellcat. So essentially, it's got all the Hellcat power with the features of the cop car, which is like it's all-wheel drive or four-wheel drive. I think it's all-wheel drive. And then a gun rack in the back, because why not?
Gotta have a gun rack.
Duh. And then all the cool cop stuff comes with it. The interior is a little basic because that's what came in the cop cars. But other than that, like, that is a cool car. I like that car.
So I have to ask, does it have the emergency lights, the strobes still?
No, it doesn't have any lights on it. It has a spotlight.
I was going to say that'll get you in trouble, as we have seen over and over. So,
yeah.
So my pick, and we didn't coordinate this, so I'm not trying to make the Chevy and the Ford people mad or anything, but I chose a 2004 Dodge Ram SRT 10.
See, you like the SRTs as well.
Well, I mean, it's a beautiful truck. This thing looks like it has been just absolutely babied since it was new. And I mean, everybody knew these were special trucks when they first came out, but somehow somebody has resisted the temptation to just thrash this thing. It only has 38,000 miles on it. The interior looks pristine, you know, and then none of the switchgear looks like it's worn out, which is really saying something for a 2004 Ram. So see, now the Ford and GM people can be happy I said that.
Yeah.
But, you know, the SRT10's, you know, dropping the Viper engine in it, that was epic. It's one of the greatest trucks ever made. Even though I really love off-roaders, and in general, I'm not so much into the sport trucks, you know, the Lightnings and the Cyclones and so on. I mean, these are cool trucks. So, yeah, that was my pick for the week.
I was expecting you to pick an off-roader, to be honest. But I know the truck you're talking about, the beautiful red truck, doesn't look like it's had a drop of water on it ever. And that's crazy for being, you know, a 2005 is what you said.
Yeah, it's 2004. Yeah.
2004. Yeah, even better. All right. Well, we're going to link to these cars and everything else. We're going to link to the stories in the description. We're going to wrap it up. Thanks for tuning in. Leave us a comment. And like I said, we'll be back regularly to talk about the things that you want to talk about. Thanks for tuning in.